Welcome. In this lecture of macroeconomics, we would understand government budget and economy. Now to understand, the private sector is one of the sectors, the public sector is another sector. In a country like India, we have a mix of public and private sector, and therefore we call our economy as a mixed economy. But whenever a mixed economy runs, there are expenses that are borne by the government. So government have certain extra expenditure to maintain the roads, flyovers, networks, water supply, sewage supply, all those would be taken care by the government. So there would be certain expenditures. But on the other hand, the government also earns through the taxes, the direct taxes, the indirect taxes. So this whole accounts for the budget. Now, revenue is the income generated. Expenditure is the things that the government has to pay. So if I say revenue is equal to expenditure, that means there is no loss, no profit. If revenue is greater than expenditure, in that case, what would happen? There would be profit or budget surplus, we can say simply. If the revenue is less than the expenditure, then there would be a deficit. We call this as budget deficit. So to begin with, the very simple understanding is, in a country like India, there is an annual financial statement. This annual financial statement accounts for all the receipts of the government, the expenses, the income over 1 year, and that accounts for the budget. So budget indicates the borrowings that the government has done, the expenses that the government would make, the income that the government is generating. So it's bifurcated under two heads, revenue and expenditure, right? So these two together form the budget, which is laid down as part of the annual financial statement from the financial year of 1st April to 31st March. And this accounts for the basis for the budget. Now, as I said, there can be revenue assets and there can be capital assets. So two types of assets are revenue assets and capital assets. What is the difference? Under the revenue budget and the capital budget, what all things are included? So capital budget includes the assets and the liabilities. However, revenue budget is a budget that relates only to the current financial year. Right? So under revenue budget, I am focusing only on the current financial year. Under a capital budget, I talk about the assets, the liabilities that the country would have. So if we talk about the objectives of a budget, the objectives are simply threefold. What are those? One is allocation. The second is redistribution. And the third is stabilization. Redistribution means what? Redistribution means there is national income. The national income would go into private hands. A segment would go to the government. The private entities would pay taxes. And the remaining personal disposable income of the private would be spent. And the money which is going to the government would be redistributed to the poor, to the needy, to the society development. And therefore, the budget has an idea of redistribution. The money should go rightly into the hands of all those who require it. The next is the purpose of stabilization. That means if there is income or unemployment cycle, any fluctuations in income or unemployment, that would be fixed through the process of stabilization, right? So in the times where the economy is performing weak, there is higher levels of unemployment, the government would offer employment opportunities. If there is a scenario of oversaturation, then there would be more avenues that would be open for the same. So underemployment, overemployment, income generation, all of those have to be stabilized so that the economy keeps running smoothly. So stabilization is another important aspect. So if I say demand is greater than output, that means there is high employment. High employment would lead to inflation. Now, once there is inflation, government needs to bring in restrictions. Otherwise, the inflation would further soar up. So, if the demand is more, there is to be more people who are getting employment, higher levels of inflation, and this would lead to bringing in restrictions in the society. The next is allocation. Now, allocation of the resources. There, the goods can be classified into two ways. Public goods as well as private goods. Private goods is I own a house, I own a car, I own a cycle. Public goods are roads, street lights, water systems. So all those are public goods. Now public goods, there are two important characteristics. One is it is non-rivalrous. That means private good, if I own a car, my friend would say I also want to own a car. So there is a rivalry. There is no rivalry with public good. I take enough air, I want to breathe. My friend would also take enough air, they want to breathe. So, public goods are non-rivalrous. The second is, they are non-excludable. That means they cannot be excluded. Anyone who wants it would get it. If there is a road, there is a street light, you can enjoy that street light. A person living on the roadside can also enjoy that street light. However, if that was a private good, if it is a light which I have put in my house, which gives a little light to the street, I can probably turn it around and say that it should only fall in my house and not on the street. So for private goods are excludable. If you want, you can provide it to others. If you don't want, you won't provide it to others. But public goods are non-excludable. That means no one is excluded. Everyone can enjoy it. Everyone can have it. Whatsoever condition it could be, good, average or better. And everyone can actually have that facility at par with others. So that's what is the basic characteristic of a public good. Clear? So two important characteristics under allocation of goods, public and private. Under public, the public goods are non-rivalrous. They are non-excludable. But there is another important term that you must be familiar here, which is public provisions and public goods. What is the difference? Public goods are the goods that can be produced by the government, okay, for the betterment of the society. Public provisions are the facilities which are made available and can be used without direct payments. So even if I am not paying for that road light, so let's say I pay a tax, so I am paying for the road light maintenance. But a person who is living on the roadside would not be paying the tax, but is still be enjoying that public provision. That means public provision is meant for all, whether you are incorporating as a person to pay for it, or if even if you are not incorporating as a person to pay for it. Public goods, on the other hand, are actually the goods which are meant for everyone, and they can be produced by the government sector, right? Now, if I broadly classify a budget, I can classify this budget under two heads. What are those two heads? It's the revenue budget and the capital budget. As I said, revenue budget is the current financial year and it is non-redeemable. Capital budget is the asset and the liabilities. Now under revenue, I can further classify the revenue budget as revenue receipts and revenue expenditure. And capital budget again as capital receipts and capital expenditure. Let's understand this one by one. As I said, revenue budget is non-redeemable. It talks about current financial year. So what would include, what would be included under revenue receipt? All kinds of taxes. So for an individual, it would be direct income tax. For a firm, it would be a corporate tax. There can be indirect tax like GST, customs tax on the things coming from outside, imported goods, excise tax on the things produced within the country. Now, customs, excise, indirect tax. Besides this, there is another term which is used, which is known as paper tax. Paper tax is a term which is used for wealth tax, gift tax, and estate tax. All of these, they never bring out a huge proportion. They don't contribute to a huge revenue, but they are still there. And therefore, they are on paper, as simple as that. So we call them as paper tax. They are there, but they are not affecting the system in the huge amount. Now, important to note, income tax is progressive. As your income increases, the amount of tax you would pay would increase. So the income tax is progressive in nature. Again, sometimes in indirect taxes, which is on the goods and services, necessities are exempted. Right? So this is about revenue expenditure. Coming on revenue receipts. Coming on to revenue expenditure. Revenue expenditure can be classified as planned expenditure or non-plan expenditure. Right? Plan expenditure is what? Plan expenditure is a central expenditure. It is by the central government. So it could be center's assistance to the state, center's assistance to the union territory. It could be in the form of 5-year plan, but anything which is well designed and well articulated would go under planned revenue expenditure. You know, where are you going to spend this year? At the center, at the state, at the union level, at the various plans which are formulated. Non-plan expenditure is an interesting expenditure because this would include things which are not actually planned. So what would it include? Salaries, pensions, subsidies, defense services, or defense expenditure, I can say, interest payments. If the government has taken loan, government would pay the interest for the same. Okay, there can be external loans, right? All of these would go under non-plan revenue expenditure. Clear? So we have revenue expenditure as planned expenditure and non-plan expenditure. Now coming on to capital receipts. Capital receipts can be as loans. Now those who are taking loan, there would be interest on the loan that the government would have to repay after some period of time. So it creates liability. So the loans would create liability. There can be disinvestment of PSUs. The public sector undertakings can be disinvested and income can be raised or amount can be raised. So we call this as sale of assets. Assets that the government has, government can sell those assets. For example, we are talking about sale of Air India, Coal India. So that's the sale of the assets. Now, PSUs, the public sector undertakings, are disinvested. Disinvested means more than 50% of the stake, if goes to the private, we call that company as a disinvested company. That means the majority share is now by the private entity, not by the government. Again, if the government has taken loan for some purpose, then there is a liability to repay that loan in certain duration. So those are capital receipts. So capital receipts mainly forms the assets and the liabilities that are taken into account. And these assets and the liabilities can be debt or non-debt creating. Clear? So they can be either debt creating, they can be non-debt creating. The next is capital expenditure. Now, what is included under capital expenditure? Capital expenditure is anything which is done as an expenditure, but that is an asset. So when I say it is an asset, it could be a capital, a land, a building, machinery, equipment, investment in shares, advancement for the loans which are given to the central, the center gives to the state, the center gives to the union territory. So again, capital expenditure can also be classified as plan and non-plan. So plan is centers assistance to the state, centers assistance to the union territory, anything that is meant for the overall building purpose. The non-plan includes the socio-economic services. Clear? So that would be part of the non-plan expenditure. Now, since we have done this, the next thing that we need to take into account is this was the classification of budget. Now, if the revenue equals the expenditure, okay, so if the revenue receipts are equal to the expenditure, then the total receipts, the revenue and the capital receipts and the expenditures are equal, then the budget is balanced. If the receipts are more, there is budget surplus. If the receipts are less than the expenditure, there is budget deficit, as we can understand, right? Now, when I say deficit, what does it imply? Deficit simply implies that my expenditure is greater than my revenue. That means probably I am dissaving. My savings are not optimum. Okay, so in that case, my expenditures would be more. I can have lots of liabilities, lots of interest repayments that have to be done. So if I say, what is fiscal deficit? I can simply say fiscal deficit is the total expenditure minus revenue receipts plus the non-debt capital receipts. Now, what would this non-debt capital receipt include? Non-debt capital receipt would include recovery from loan, sale of asset, so any PSU being disinvested, okay? All that would be part of the non-debt capital receipt. So that's what is fiscal deficit. Now, I can also write fiscal deficit as revenue deficit. Okay, that would be revenue receipts, revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts plus the capital expenditure minus the non-debt capital receipts, which is this one, right? Now, this revenue deficit includes what? Revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts. Okay, this is what is revenue deficit. Now, this revenue deficit actually is a large part of the consumption expenditure. Why? Because we are talking about revenue expenditure, which is on a year-to-year basis. And since it is revenue expenditure, not capital expenditure, it does not focus on investments. When it is capital expenditure, it would focus on buildings, machineries, land, infrastructure. So that would focus on investment, right? However, revenue expenditure would focus on consumptions. It's basically on a year-to-year basis, what are the things which are required? So that's how we understand fiscal deficit. So fiscal deficit has to be financed through the borrowings. And then we also talk about another term which is known as gross primary deficit. What is gross primary deficit? It is the gross fiscal deficit minus net interest liabilities. So net interest liabilities are what? Net interest liabilities are interest payments minus the interest payments by the government. So, interest payment minus the interest payment by government on various domestic lendings. So, we call this as gross primary deficit. So, those are some of the terms that we have discussed. Now, growth in the revenue expenditure. It's very important to understand why do I say so? Because when I say growth in the revenue expenditure, it is explained as percentage of the fiscal deficit and it is actually determining the position of the country in terms of whether the country is running losses, whether the country is running more expenditures than revenue, and the public debt is again a matter of concern, because if there is higher public debt, that means there are lesser opportunities for growth in the future, because the country would be repaying those debt. If I have taken a huge amount of loan and I have a huge amount of interest payments that have to be done, that means I am in a public debt. My major concern would be to repay those debt in the first go, and once those are repaid, then only I can think about further developments and further scenarios, right? So that's again an important issue. But to summarize, this is what is the budget picture. So we have revenue budget and capital budget. Revenue budget is revenue receipts, revenue expenditure, capital receipts and capital expenditure. What are included under each of those? Extremely important, we have covered those systematically. So it gives a very clear picture. This graph itself gives a very clear picture of the budget. In the next section, we would talk about the fiscal policy and certain examples and certain numericals. It is about fiscal policy. Why fiscal policy is an important constituent when economy is facing ups and downs? Fiscal policy actually regulate. So what happens is, when the cycle of employment and income generation is affected, this fiscal policy is brought as a measure by government, and this actually regulates the amount of employment opportunities in an economy, and also make sure that the income and the disposable income that a person holds is normalized. So fiscal policies are aimed to actually increase the output in the economy, to increase the income in the economy. So those are the basic ideas which are laid down under the fiscal policy. Now, the most important thing is, there is surplus when the receipts in an economy are more than the expenditure, and there is a deficit when the receipts are less than the expenditure. That is something that we have already discussed. Now, to balance this deficit, what is required? There has to be a lump sum tax. Now, this lump sum tax, which is levied by the government, would be an indicator that this would actually fill in the deficit gap. The tax which is being collected would be used, and that would generate the receipts. So that's a good idea to balance the deficit in the economy that's working. Now, so aggregate demand is what? Aggregate demand can be explained as a consumption pattern with the income minus the taxes plus the constant amount of transfers that a government is doing plus the investments and the government expenditure. To keep it simple, I can say change in income by change in government spending would be equal to 1 upon 1 minus C, where C is the marginal propensity to consume. Marginal propensity to consume. So that means, let's say if C is 0.8, what would be this fraction? This fraction would be 1 upon 1 minus 0.8, which is 1 upon 0.2, that is 5. What does this 5 figure implies? It implies that if my government spending increases by 100, then my equilibrium income would increase by 500. As simple as that. So I represent it by change in income by change in expenditure. The next is change in income by change in taxation, which is minus C divided by 1 minus C. So let's say my C in this case is 0.8. So minus 0.8 divided by 1 minus 0.8, which is minus 4. That means if the tax cut is increased by 100, then the equilibrium income amount increases by 400, but this 400 is still less than the income amount of 500 when the government spending was involved. So that's another thing that you have to remember. Now, when I take both of these together, I found change in income by change in expenditure, which would be 1 upon 1 minus C plus minus C upon 1 minus C, and that would give me 1, which is unity. Now, this 1 is an indicative that the balanced budget multiplier of unity, implying that if there is 100 increase in the government spendings, then there would be 100 increase in the tax spend or the tax income which is generated. Now, this is something which has been extremely important for us to understand. So also we say proportional income tax is a great stabilizer. Why proportional income tax is a great stabilizer? Because every segment of the society would be charged accordingly. So people in the higher strata would be charged more tax as compared to people in the lower strata. So we say this is an automatic stabilizer, and it just balances any kind of fluctuations that occur in GDP. Another important thing is, when the gross domestic product increases, the disposable income of a person increases, but the proportion in which the disposable income would increase is not the same as the GDP increase. The reason being, a fraction of it goes into taxation. So a part of it would go into tax, and that tax would be levied by the government itself, and therefore the disposable income in the hand of the persons is not exactly rising in the same amount as the GDP is rising. Now, whenever the government suffers deficit, this deficit can be financed into three ways. The first way is to print more currency. So printing of money is a good way of financing the deficit. The second important is taxation. The government can increase the taxes. These could be proportional, progressive taxes, which is mainly the income tax, which act as an automatic stabilizer. The third way out could be borrowing. Now, government can borrow the amount from other organizations, and that way the government can fulfill its deficit for once. So what happens? Under a very interesting concept, which is known as Ricardian equivalence, under this concept of Ricardian equivalence, the concept simply says, when there are times of high deficit, people tend to save more. So the simple logic says, under Ricardian equivalence, that when there is high deficit, people would tend to save more amount of money. Okay, but again, what happens? Taxations and borrowings are equivalent important means of financial spending or financial expenditure, right? So either government could increase the tax or increase the borrowing, and by increasing the tax or the borrowing, the amount in the government machinery increases, which could be a way for spending for the financial projects. Now, when the government spending increases because of borrowing, so I first take the example of borrowing. When the spending is increasing because of the borrowing, what would happen? This would lead to increase in the tax in future. Now, this would have a greater impact on the economy. And as the government increase the expenditure, which is financed by the tax increase, which is today, so this expenditure increase would be financed by the tax increase. Now, when the government is borrowing more, definitely government would have to repay this borrowing. So in order to repay this borrowing, what would government do? Government would increase the taxations, and then this taxation would have an impact on whom? This taxation would have an impact onto the common man. So increase in the expenditure would ultimately have a burden on the common man in the form of increasing taxation. So increasing taxation would be another important thing that you must take into account. The next is FRBMA, which is the Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act. Now, Fiscal Responsibility and Budget Management Act, this was brought in 2003. The idea under this is that fiscal deficit should not be more than 3% of the GDP, eliminate any kind of revenue deficit that occurs. Central government would not borrow from RBI except to meet its advances, which are mainly in the form of excess cash. Right? The next important thing is, RBI should not subscribe to its primary issue of central government. Central government would lay down three statements which are important, and there would be a quarterly review of the various projects and the finances that are taken into account. So the three statements that are laid down under the government would be what? The three statements which are laid down under the government would be medium term fiscal report, and this would be on a 3-year rolling basis. The next would be a fiscal policy strategy management, a fiscal policy strategy statement, and this would give priority of the government on the various fiscal areas. The last one would be a macroeconomic framework. This macroeconomic framework would talk about the economic prospects with the GDP and therefore would focus on to the macroeconomic scenarios. So the three statements are important: the medium term fiscal policy, the fiscal policy strategy statement, and the macroeconomic fiscal statement. So those three would be the three statements which are part of the Fiscal Revenue Budget Management Act 2003. So the idea is to cap it to 3% of the GDP, remove the fiscal deficit, remove the RBI borrowings except for the advances for excess cash, primary issue of the central government by RBI, launch of three statements, and the quarterly review of the statement. So in this lecture, we have talked about the government spending. Primarily, we have talked about the revenue and the capital expenditure and the revenue and the capital budget. Now, once we have talked about the expenditures and the receipts in both the cases, we need to understand that this has been laid down under the idea of fiscal policy. Now, to understand the fiscal policy, the government deficit needs to be understood, and this deficit is again governed by three elements, which is first of all the borrowings. Then you have the elements which pertain to printing of the currency, and then there is another important aspect to cope up this deficit is the policy of taxation. So these three concepts to deal with the issues of deficit are extremely important. So this was about the fifth chapter on NCERT macroeconomics. The highlights we have covered here, and the more concepts, if you want to go into the details, feel free to post those in the comment section if you have queries regarding these.